All right, if you'll take your Bible tonight, turn over to the book of Luke and go to chapter 8. Now, I'll say that my wife does a great job of scheduling the music. She has to coincide on all different kinds of schedules that people have in other ministries to try to get them at the right place and the right time. But how I ended up on there twice today, I'm not sure if it has anything to do with me mentioning the biscuits being burned the other night or what, but I'm not sure how that worked out. But anyway, if you'll find your place in Luke chapter 8, we've been looking through the book of Luke, and we'll look tonight at this second part of this chapter, and we'll begin with a word of prayer. Lord, how we thank you for the word of God tonight, that we can open this book, that you've given it to us, revealed yourself through it, and even tonight especially as we consider the Lord Jesus Christ and his ministry and his seeking and saving that which was lost. Lord, I pray tonight that you'd stir our hearts, cause each person to be helped and challenged. May the word of God have free course. May it be glorified. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, of course, as we've looked at this book and we remember the theme that Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. Many of the instances that are recorded in Luke, of course, we can find in Mark and we can find in Matthew, and each one has a different message and a perspective that they give. But as I think about Jesus going through here, and we dealt with the first part of this chapter, but in the second part, there are several miracles that he performs in this chapter, and I'm reminded that when he performs these physical miracles, he was fulfilling the scripture, just like we pointed out in an earlier chapter. It was not merely to demonstrate that he had power to do it, though it did that. It was not that he came to meet every physical need, because there were Gentiles who would have liked to have their needs met. He did not, by commonplace, deal with the Gentiles. There were a few exceptions, but for the most part, he didn't come except to the house of Israel. He came and he performed physical miracles, and there was a purpose in that. The purpose was it had been prophesied that when Messiah had come, that he would anoint the eyes of the blind, and that he would open up the deaf ears, that he would preach the gospel to the poor. And so he fulfills them with these miracles, and far more miracles are recorded than we have, or that took place rather, than are recorded in the scripture. But now when it came to these miracles, they certainly fulfilled the scripture, but they also have another purpose. They illustrate spiritual truth. Now, Jesus still works miracles today. When he saves people, he does a tremendous miracle. Someone may say, well, shouldn't we today have the same expectation? That is, if we have a blind person, couldn't we lay hands on them and pray and ask God, and just like Jesus said, greater works than these shall you do? But it was never God's intention to work physical miracles on all the known humanity, because he does something far greater than that. Now, God still heals people, don't get me wrong, but he does not use faith healers. Jesus had a specific purpose in healing himself. He had a specific purpose when he sent his disciples out to heal, and a specific purpose, if you'll note, in the book of Acts when the apostles went out to fulfill his words in the book of John. But when the scripture was fulfilled, and we ourselves can go directly to God and we can pray, every believer has a right to go to God and say, God, I have a physical need. So when God met the physical need, for instance, for the Jew in the Gospels, he was fulfilling a direct reference in Scripture, and obviously he worked these miracles, and it did what it was supposed to do. Nicodemus came and said, no man can do these miracles except God be with him. You know, there will be another miracle worker who will come, and people are going to be fooled by him. Just because one can work miracles does not make that person the Messiah. Do you realize when the Antichrist comes, and of course the church will not be here, but people are going to be deceived because he's going to do great signs and lying wonders. Well, now, God could allow wonders to take place that we can't explain, and he might do to test us, but the test of truth is not the miracle. The test of truth is how does it line up with what this book says. Now, when I look at miracles, I see these miracles, I know that God has the power to work a miracle. Why would he do a miracle in my life today? Well, God can do a miracle of physical healing. In fact, we've had testimonies right in our own church multiple times. Someone says, I have a dire need. It doesn't even look good. This person may not even live. And frankly, a couple of times on Wednesday night, I've heard that, and I thought, well, we'll pray for this person, but it doesn't sound good. And then next week, well, wasn't as bad as we thought. Well, it may have been as bad as you thought, but God answered prayer. I mean, God still answers prayer, but why does He do it today? He answers prayer on behalf of believers as a loving Father who is meeting the need of His children. But when God did miracles in the Gospels, it was more than merely meeting the need for someone He loved, though He did, but it was simply fulfilling and demonstrating He had authority to do so. Now, in this chapter, especially, we see it in many chapters, but especially in this chapter, we note Jesus now is seeking and saving that which was lost. So He demonstrates His authority to do just that. See, He's the only one who can save. Nobody else can seek a sinner, and nobody else can save a sinner but the Lord Jesus Christ. And so He demonstrates His authority in this chapter in several ways. I want you to go, these are familiar accounts, but look down to verse 22. It says, "It came to pass on a certain day that He went into a ship with the disciples and said unto them, Let us go over unto the other side of the lake. And they launched forth. As they sailed, He fell asleep. There came down a storm of wind on the lake, and they were filled with water and were in jeopardy. And they came to Him and awoke Him, saying, Master, Master, we perish. Then He arose, rebuked the wind and the raging of the water, and they ceased, and there was a calm. And He said unto them, Where is your faith? And they, being afraid, wondered, saying one to another, What manner of man is this, that he commandeth even the winds and the water, that they obey Him?" You know, it's remarkable that the disciples, who had heard John the Baptist give testimony, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world," they came to Him and said, "We want to follow You. We believe that You're the Messiah." And when Jesus stands and rebukes the wind, they ask the question, "What manner of man is this?" Well, He was a man, but He is the God-man. They had not gathered the full impact of His authority. If they knew who Jesus really was, and He was on that ship, really, in true faith, they wouldn't have had to worry about it sinking. And even if it did sink, it would have been the world's first submarine, because they would have come right out the other side and would have had no problem. Jesus was on the ship. Now, what He demonstrates by waking up from this ship, walking up to the top, and you get the picture. I mean, this ship is tossing and turning, water coming over the top of it. It's a little, you know, wooden structure that they use for fishing. I mean, storms would come up in the Sea of Galilee often, and many ships would never make it. And they figured, we're just another statistic. We're going to be gone. Jesus is asleep on a pillow in the bottom of the ship. They come down and say, "Master, we perish." Jesus comes up on that ship, and of course the disciples are, you know, hanging on anything they can hang on to. It's rocking, it's reeling back and forth, and He just says, "Peace, be still." And it was like glass out there on the Sea of Galilee. Now, what a remarkable account, but He demonstrated something. His authority over disaster. They said, "We're in jeopardy. Nothing we can do about this." Do you know, obviously, the one who made the earth and the sea can say to the sea, "Be still," and it has to obey. You know, there's a lot of things about this account that we can learn, but I think to myself, you know, a raging sea responds to the voice of God. It must. If Jesus says, "Peace, be still," it doesn't have any choice in the matter. It's going to be still. And yet God has given a sinner an ability to reject what Jesus said. There's great consequences to doing so. But amazing thing to think that the sea, who has no brain, who has no will or thought, will listen to the voice of God. But you know, we'd be better off if we listened to His voice. Now, He demonstrated authority over a very difficult disaster that's taking place. And I say that, yes, this was a physical miracle, but it illustrates a spiritual truth. Do you know that the seeking Savior still has power over disasters in our life? You know, I see that, first of all, He demonstrates that by His promise. You know what He told the disciples in verse 22? Look toward the end there. If you have a red-letter Bible, you'll notice the little red statement. It says, "Let us go over unto the other side of the lake." You know, if I get on a ship with Jesus, and He says, "I'm getting on this ship, and we're going to go to the other side," do you know all the forces of hell wasn't going to keep that ship from getting to the other side? He made a promise. You say, "Well, that's great. The disciples probably didn't recognize who He was, and they should have known that ship wasn't going to sink." But do you realize Jesus has made me a promise? A believer in the Lord Jesus Christ has clear promise that we're going to make it to the other side. I'm not hanging on for dear life. I'm not hoping that the storm doesn't wipe me out. I'm not doing the best I can and see how it turns out. I'm not waiting to the last day of my life and just, boy, maybe if I can hold out to the very end and see how it turns out. Listen to the promise of God. John 5:24. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. I'm not waiting to be passed. I'm not waiting to get everlasting life. I already have it. I'm passed from death unto life. It's a done deal. I mean, Romans chapter 8, the question, who could separate us from the love of Christ? I mean, he says, I am convinced nothing could do that, not peril, not difficulty, not principalities. Nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. That is a promise from God. Let us go to the other side. But you know, also demonstrated it by his power. Now, I don't know about you, because we're weak, because we ought to always just take the promise of God and say, God said it, that settles it. But I know as well as you do that we've seen God work, and that increases our faith. We've watched him keep his word. You know, Philippians 1:6, he which hath begun a good work in you is able to perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Has God begun a good work in you? You know, I know the devil has come to people. And if the one thing the devil doesn't want a Christian to have, if you're truly born again, he doesn't want you to have assurance. I mean, certainly if I am shaky on that, I'm not going to effectively serve. So he comes and he tries to get us to question. But I stop and I think about the first, he that hath begun a good work in you. Has God done anything in my heart? Has he given me a desire for his word? I may not always desire it like I ought to, but has he given me a desire to know it? Has God given me a heart to know him? Has God changed me in a way that I'm interested in the things of God? I mean, he began something in me. He obviously did, but you know, sometimes I fail. God has begun a good work. Sometimes I blow it. Sometimes I don't have the interest I ought to have and the focus I ought to have. Sometimes I actually am an idolater. I put something ahead of God. But he that begun the good work is going to perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. I'm not going to perform it. Now, these men could have said, we're going to get this ship. We got Jesus down there sleeping. No need to bother him. We'll get it to the other side. Well, if they had enough faith, they could have just hung on, strapped themselves to the boat. In fact, they wouldn't even have to strap themselves to the boat, because he said, let us go to the other side. I mean, they could have gone out and water skied behind that thing, and they were going to get over there. But we don't, even though it's that obvious to us, when you're going through the disaster, it's not always that obvious. When you're going through the difficulty and all those, the wind's blowing in your face and the water's coming over the bow of the ship, in your head, I know I can trust God. But my clothes are all wet. The ship is just about to fall apart. But Jesus still came out and said, where is your faith? But you know what? He didn't come out and say, well, you don't have any faith. I'm going to let the thing sink. He said, where is your faith? And then he saved them. You know, sometimes God has to ask me, where is your faith? But that doesn't mean he's not going to keep saving me. Now, God has authority over disaster. I keep reading in this chapter, and I notice another account. You'll notice now, in verse 26, they arrive at the country of the Gerasenes, which is over against Galilee. He went forth to the land. There met him out of the city a certain man which had devils long time. Now, you know there's only one devil, a slanderer, Satan. We know his origin. When you see devils in the Bible, plural, or you see a devil rather than the devil, it's really a demon. In fact, the word is daimonion, which is where we get the word demon. It's not the word diabolos. You recognize those terms, which is slanderer. This is one of those places. And of course, you see that throughout the Gospels. This is not the devil himself, but it's multiple demons that are in this man. Now, this was unique in that he went forth and he found this man that had devils. And then notice it says long time. So he'd been demon-possessed for years. He wear no clothes, neither abode in any house, but in the tombs. Sounds like San Francisco to me, but anyway. It says, when he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell down before him and with a loud voice and says, what have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I beseech thee, torment me not. You know what Jesus is going to show us in this passage? He has authority over demons. Now, do you know there's still demonic activity that takes place? The demons didn't quit operating after the Gospels was over. Though I will say that when Jesus died on the cross, it appears that their earthly ability was diminished somewhat, but there's demonic activity. It's often hidden. You see what happens with a demon-possessed person in the Gospels. Usually, it goes in spells. They don't always demonstrate the demon possession. They'll throw themselves in the fire. That is, they try to harm themselves. They didn't have shotguns to blow their heads off back in that day. They'll throw themselves in the fire. They, like in this particular instance, had superhuman strength. He was able to break bonds and so forth. He wore no clothes, and he was sleeping in the tombs. You know, some of the stuff that we would just pass off as mental illness is probably nothing more than demon possession. That doesn't mean every mentally ill person's demon possessed, but many of the stuff we'd pass off and say, well, the guy just had a mental issue. When a man would go out and indiscriminately murder multiple people and then turn the gun on himself, I've concluded many times that person's demon possessed. Demons hadn't quit operating. When somebody opens their mind up and their heart up and everything about them with drugs, well, they open up and invite a demon in. They remove their inhibitions, and demons are seeking a place to land. You say, well, isn't that Old Testament, or isn't that a long time ago? Demons still operate today. Now, there's going to be unusual demonic activity during the tribulation, but there's demonic activity in our day. All you have to do is read what happened, and you see it in modern conditions. I said it not somewhat tongue-in-cheek. It sounds like San Francisco, but when people can live in a big old area, drug needles all over the place, have no interest in being in a house, public nudity, violence, murder, do you think demonism is not involved in that? No doubt there's some demonism involved. Now, Jesus didn't walk up to this demon-possessed guy and say, well, you disciples, you come on. This guy's too far gone. Look how bad he's living. Jesus looked at a demon-possessed man and said, I have authority over those demons. You know who else recognized it? The demons. They said, Jesus, you've come to torment us before the time. You know how I said the ocean, when God tells them what to do, the ocean answers. When demons are told by God to do something, the demons answer. They knew when Jesus showed up, we're already destined. We're going to be judged. Our time is short, and you've come to shorten it more. Well, Jesus told these demons what he wanted them to do. Now, I noticed a demonic influence. We read that in the text. When they were influenced by the demons influenced this man for evil. You know, the Bible says in 2 Timothy 3:1 that in the last days, which we're in, there's going to be men that will depart from the faith, not from their faith, but the faith, and they will be doctrines of devils. You know, some demons are violent. Other demons are indwell preachers and influence doctrine. You know, don't think all demons are the same. All of them don't do this. There's all different kinds, and they all have a different purpose. Now, Jesus has authority over all of them. He meets this man in the tomb, and of course, when he meets this man in verse 30, or I'm sorry, back in verse 29, when he had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man, for oftentimes it had caught him, he was kept bound with chains and in fetters, and he brake the bands and was driven of the devil into the wilderness. Jesus asked him, saying, what is thy name? He said, Legion, because many devils were entering into him. And he besought him that he would not command them to go out into the deep. And there was a herd of many swine feeding on the mountain. And they besought him that he would suffer to enter into them, and he suffered them. Well, then the devils went out of the man and entered into the swine, and the herd ran violently down a steep place into the lake and were choked. Well, now, these hogs, some couple of thousand hogs, couldn't handle the demons that were in this man. This man was overtaken by a legion, which is 6,000 if it was a Roman soldiers. It could have been 6,000 demons that were in this man, which is remarkable in itself. And his life was ruined. But Jesus came and cast out the demon. You see, Jesus simply speaks the word to 6,000 demons. They must obey. Now, the state of this man was an awful state. But you know what's really remarkable here is Jesus comes in and he cast out the demon. Well, there's some people keeping the hogs. Here's the swine keepers, and they see this confrontation. Oh, man, Jesus and his disciples, they're dealing with the crazy man. What is he going to do? And they watched. And actually, there was more than one. We find out in a gospel account, just one is focused on here. He's dealing with those crazy guys. Wonder what Jesus is going to do with them. And they're sitting there watching, and all of a sudden, that man maybe cries out. And then they look at their hogs, and they begin to go crazy, and they run down a deep place and commit hogicide. I mean, this really caused a stir. I mean, this man thought, what is going on? So they go back to town, and they relay the story. You know what happens when the town people come back? They see the man clothed and in his right mind sitting at the feet of Jesus. Well, they ought to be thrilled. This old menacing couple of demon-possessed people out here side of our town, we've tried to put chains on them. Didn't do any good. We've tried to bind them with fetters. They'd break them. I mean, we've had them hurt people, cause violence. They run around with no clothes on, and they scream, cutting themselves. And I can't even believe it. I can hardly recognize him. He's sitting, clothed, and in his right mind because he met Jesus. So we would think to ourselves, well, surely the town would be thrilled to have somebody come in like Jesus. Somebody come in to demonstrate authority over demons. They're going to be glad to see him, welcome him in. Jesus, we got some other people we need you to meet. But notice, if you would, down in verse 35. When they went out to see what was done, they came to Jesus and found the man out of whom the devils were departed, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. Do you know if God were to go in and clean up one of these places where sin is rampant and cause revival, and everybody, instead of going out to get drunk, they went to a Bible study, the government wouldn't be all excited. They'd try to regulate the Bible study. They found him clothed. They were afraid, and they saw it, told him about what means he was possessed, and the whole multitude, in verse 37, of the country of the Gerasenes round about besought him to depart from them. You know, man's heart is wicked, isn't it? Apart from the gospel, what hope would this human race have? Jesus comes in, turns the place upside down for good, and they want to get rid of him. You know, it shouldn't surprise us too much that the culture hadn't changed. It shouldn't surprise us that the world as it is doesn't want the Lord Jesus Christ. However, these civilized folks who weren't demon-possessed didn't want Jesus. However, the demon-possessed man didn't want him to leave. I look in verse 38. Now the man out of whom the devils were departed besought him that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return to thine own house and show how great things God hath done unto thee." I don't know about you, but there's times in my life where I want to be with him physically. I mean, you get you face some difficulties in this world, and sometimes, and of course, our preservation says, let's stay here as long as we can. But there's a part of us, even so come, Lord Jesus. Wouldn't we just be better off to go ahead and be with him? That's how this man felt. Jesus said, not right now. You got a job to do. That group that wanted to kick me out of town, I want you to go back and influence them and see if we can't win some of them. See, Jesus is interested in all sinners. He's interested in the demon-possessed sinners. He's interested in the ignorant sinner because he has power over difficulties, over detriment. He has power over disasters. He has power over demons. Then we move a little further here. Notice he has power over disease. In verse 40, it came to pass that when Jesus was returned, the people gladly received him, for they were all waiting for him. Now, he had gone out to this country of the Gerasenes, which really is not in Jerusalem. It's Jewish, but not like Orthodox. Now he comes back to the Orthodox Jews, and they're waiting on him. They gladly received him because they want to see a miracle. Behold, there was a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue. He fell down at Jesus' feet and besought him that he would come into his house, for he had only one daughter, about 12 years of age, and she lay a dying. As he went, the people thronged him. Now, as he's going to heal this daughter, it says in verse 43 that a woman having an issue of blood 12 years, which had spent all her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any, came behind him and touched the border of his garment. You know, when I think about this woman, she comes to Jesus, and it says that she had sought many physicians and was nothing bettered. I believe it is the book of Mark that says not only was she nothing bettered, she rather grew worse. Do you know there's plenty of folks that have the same disease? She had a disease of the blood. Now hers was a physical disease of the blood, but there's plenty of folks with a spiritual blood disease. We got our blood from Adam. Adam gave us our sin nature. You know, our sin nature destroys us. Our sin nature is our enemy. We can't do anything about it, but it's our nature. And instead of doing right, we're going to do wrong. You know, you don't have to train a little baby to do wrong. You got to train them to keep them from doing wrong, because our default position is to do wrong. Well, this woman had a long time problem, and her problem was a physical disease, and we have a long time problem. It's sin. And that sin is destructive. She sought many physicians to be bettered, and the world is doing that exact thing. The world looks for all types of things to overcome, to hide, to masquerade, to try to make sin better. But sin can't be covered, masqueraded, or evaded. It's got to be dealt with through the blood of Jesus Christ. She had gone to many physicians, but she hadn't met the great physician. Well, now she hears about him coming. All these people are thronging him. Probably difficult to even get to him at all, but she's able to work herself through the crowd. She's a sickly woman, not much energy, but it's going to be worth it. And you know, it's not that it takes effort to get to Jesus in the sense of works, but the Bible does talk about diligence. He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. You say, well, if we're saved not by works but by grace, how can I be diligent to get to Jesus? I believe the diligence is not allowing distraction to keep you from getting there. Now, the devil loves to distract. I can't earn the grace of God. That would be an irony in itself. Grace is not earned. It's unmerited. I can't earn it, but you can be serious about receiving it. You see, when a person diligently seeks the Lord, that is, they're earnest, they want to know Him. Nobody has ever diligently sought Him and not found Him. You see, if you seek for Him with all your heart, the Bible says, you're going to find Him. Now, this woman physically made her way, didn't let the distraction, didn't let the hindrance reach in, and I can almost see her. She can't, everybody's up high, so she reaches down and it says the border of His garment. Well, it could have been His sleeve, I suppose, but I see her grabbing the border of that thing. He'll never know. Whew, immediately in her body, she said, wow, I knew He was powerful, but I didn't know how powerful. And you know, that's what a lost man says when he gets saved. I knew He was powerful, but boy, I just didn't know how powerful. And you want to, you experience His power. Now, this woman was immediately cured, and I don't know if she thought, well, I wish I could thank Him, but there's too many people around Him. I guess I'll make my way on back. Boy, I tell you, isn't that something? And all of a sudden, the crowd stops, and it gets quiet, and she hears a voice, who touched me? Well, the disciples look around and said, you see the crowd thronging you? And you say, who touched me? Well, many people had physically touched Jesus, but that particular instance, only one person touched Him spiritually with the touch of faith. And of course, the woman comes back, confesses, and if you'll notice in verse 47, when the woman saw that she was not hid, she came trembling and falling down before Him, and she declared unto Him before all the people for what cause she had touched Him and how she was healed immediately. And He said unto her, daughter, be of good comfort, thy faith hath made thee whole. Not your effort, not your works. It wasn't the fact that you grabbed my garment, but faith put feet on it, and because you did that, go in peace. You know, there is no disease too great for Jesus. And there, you can name any disease you want, and you might be greatly encouraged to think, well, I have a debilitating disease and a terrible prognosis physically. Yes, Jesus could help your physical need. But the great disease is sin. And Jesus has authority to overcome it. There is no human cure for sin, but Jesus can cure it, and He can overcome it. So He had authority over the disaster, over the disease, over the demons. But then notice again where Jesus was headed. He was headed to Jairus' house. And while He spake to this woman in verse 49, there cometh one from the ruler of the synagogue's house saying to Him, thy daughter is dead. Trouble not the master. It's too late. Well, you know, with God, spiritually, it's never too late. If you're breathing, it's never too late. Now, the message from God is that it's never too late, so you need not despair. But there's also a message from God that he that being often reproved and hardeneth his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, so you need not presume. Nobody has a right to say, I'll be saved whenever I get good and ready. You'd be wrong, because you're going to get saved when God gets ready. He calls upon you, you turn it down, oh, I'll think about it, I'll give it a little while, maybe one day. The implication is you're going to do this on your time. No, God's the Savior, you'll do it on his time. He says, my calendar only has one time right now. That's when you have to deal. On the other hand, it would be equally wrong to say, I'm too far gone. If you can make the statement, I'm too far gone, you're not too far gone. He said, it's too late, trouble not the master. Well, Jesus is never troubled when people need help. So while he yet spake, and in verse 50, Jesus heard it. He answered, saying, fear not, believe only, and she shall be made whole. When he came into the house, he suffered no man to go in save Peter, James, and John, and the father and the mother of the maiden, and all wept and bewailed her and said, weep not, she is not dead, but sleepeth. Now you say, was she just asleep? Was she just unconscious? You know, Lazarus had been dead, and he clearly was dead. He stayed dead for 4 days. And he said, we go to see my brother Lazarus. And the disciples thought, well, we're going to go see him? He says, yeah, he sleeps. Well, when they were confused, he clarified. He said, Lazarus is dead. No doubt this little girl was dead. Now, she hadn't been dead for 4 days, but she died. They knew she was dead. They checked her heartbeat. It wasn't that she just died for a minute or two. Jesus had to finish getting there. They had already wrapped her up, put her in the room, put her there for the time of mourning. They had already had time to get the mourners to come in. They were weeping over her. And Jesus quietly and privately brought Peter, James, and John and the parents into the room. And if you'll notice in verse 54, when he had put them all out and took her by the hand and called and said, maid, arise. You know, every time Jesus met somebody heading for a funeral, he'd break up the funeral. We've already seen him touch the bier. They were heading off with the procession. He breaks that one up. Here he breaks up another one. Lazarus, they'd already had probably the memorial service and maybe were getting ready to have another meal for the family or whatever it was. And Jesus came in and said, no need to have a funeral here. Because Jesus didn't just heal several people and raise a couple of people from the dead just because he happened to be there. Jesus had a message about death. He said it in John chapter 11, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Well, is that just good for the dead? Well, it's true, literally, he will raise the dead. But you know, we're all dead in our trespasses and sin. He brings us from the deadness of our trespasses and sin and gives us life. But it says, he that liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Well, that's true in the rapture. If you live, when he comes, you won't physically die. But it's also true that I'll never literally be separated from God. I'm just going to shed this body at some point. And really, that isn't that bad of a prospect. As good a body as it is, y'all get a better one. You understand that Jesus raises folks from the dead. He is the resurrection and the life. Now, he resurrects the saved. There's also a resurrection and the damnation. You're going to live somewhere forever. I mean, there is a resurrection and the life. I'm going to be part of that because of Jesus. There's a resurrection and the damnation for those that reject him. Jesus has authority. Think about the implication. He has authority over death. Right. Only one man, and it's because he's the God-man, ever could literally say, I lay down my life. I'm going to lay it down, and then I'm going to take it up again. You know, a person can commit suicide, but people have failed at suicide. You can't will yourself dead. Jesus could. He wouldn't have died from his injuries. He would have been on that cross tonight. But he said, Father, into thy hand I commend my spirit. He was smitten of God. He said, time's up. Sin's paid for. It is finished. And he separated his spirit from his body. 3 days went by. The clock hit the time. I'm going to get back up again. Jesus has power to lay his life down, power to take it up again. That's the ultimate authority on this earth. I mean, the strength of sin is the law, the sting of death. Jesus said, death, where is thy sting? Grave, where is thy victory? He has conquered death. Now, he demonstrates it with this little maid, and of course in other instances. In verse 55, her spirit came again. Therefore, she was actually dead. And she arose straightway, and he commanded to give her meat. You know, we're dead in our trespasses and sin. We've been raised again to walk in newness of life. You know what we need to do? We need to eat. Now, I know some of you like that, but I'm not talking about physical food. I'm talking about spiritual food. Newborn Christians need spiritual food. I mean, as soon as Jesus rose this girl from the dead, he said, give her something to eat. And you know, when we reach people for Christ, they've been raised again spiritually from their deadness. They need something to eat. You know why we need solid Bible-preaching churches? To feed those who've been raised from the dead. I mean, it's not enough just, okay, I'm going to heaven, just float along till I get there. God established a local church where you can be encouraged, where you can fellowship, where you can hear God's word, where you can serve, where you can be part of His ministry. He commanded to give her something to eat. You know, it's a blessing today, and that's an understatement, to be a resurrected person. I've been raised spiritually. The only thing between me and being raised physically is simply a matter of God's schedule taking place. I'm not waiting to see how it turns out. I will rise. You know, that's as old as the Bible itself. Job 26, I believe it is. I know that my Redeemer liveth and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. After my body, the skin worms destroy this body, in my flesh I shall see God. I'm not just going to be floating around on a harp, strumming something and dressed in a baby diaper or whatever you've seen in these pictures. I am going to be in my flesh. I'm going to see God and live forever with Him. This seeking Savior has authority over disaster, over demons, over disease, and over death. Let's go ahead and have a word of prayer.